Hello everyone. I, Sushmita Sarkar, Assistant Professor, Triple A Department from RV College of Engineering. I welcome you all for today's lecture number 6. So in today's lecture, we are going to see about concept of ferroresonance. So how do we go about the concept of ferroresonance and what are the indicators, how it happens? Okay, so we will see in today's lecture. So we are going to study this under the topic of sources of transient overvoltages. Fine, because this effect of ferroresonance gives the effect of transients. So we see that the a high spike of in initial voltages, whenever it happens, there will be a high rise in voltage as well as in current. So what we are going to learn in today's talk is about the concept. It's a very interesting topic, my dear friends. So we are going to see exactly what is ferroresonance, because we all are very much aware about the concept of resonance. So let us see what do you mean by a ferroresonance. So common events leading to the ferroresonance, common indicators of ferroresonance, and what are the other switching transients. So in this lecture, we are going to learn more about the concept of ferroresonance. So it is my figure represents you. It is very much related to the transformers. So we will see how the transformers gives you the effect of this ferroresonance. Fine. So when we talk about a ferroresonance, we all are aware about what is resonance. But what do you mean by ferro? Ferro is something which contains an iron. Fine. So here basically I'm talking about the transformer core. Fine. So here, when your primary currents of the transformer, the key concepts behind this, that is your, the surge currents, which strikes your primary, flows in your primary side of the transformer under no load conditions. So your saturation level reach in the core of the transformer, which is a key point in the concept to understand the ferroresonance. Fine. So what happens the ferroresonance in this particular cases? It is a special kind of resonance that involves your inductance of the transformer when it comes in series with the capacitance. Fine. So it happens basically in non-linear kind of inductance. Your circuit is containing a non-linear type of inductance and it is in series with the effect of capacitance. So when I talk about a circuit containing a non-linear inductance, which means I'm talking about a transformer or a reactors. Fine. So the most common condition in which it causes the disturbances, when the magnetizing impedance of the transformer will come in series with the capacitance effect. So basically we have an inductive component and capacitive component. So when I talk about an inductive component, it is very clear to you that is I'm talking about the transformer. When I talk about a capacitive component, that means I'm talking about your power cables. You know, these cables will have a capacitive effect with respect to the ground. Fine. So when, and this kind of phenomena occurs when there is a switching taking place, you are energizing or de-energizing the transformer, or when there is one of the lines of your three phase just gets open. Fine. So the ferroresonance is totally different from your resonance because that we talk in terms of a linear system. Fine. So in linear system, what happens? The resonance results in very high voltages and currents. But the same situation also happens in case of your ferroresonance. But with that, we have some other factors too. Fine. So in case of a linear system, the resonance results in high sinusoidal voltages and currents of the resonant frequencies. So basically they are frequency dependent. But when I talk about a ferroresonance, so ferroresonance also gives you a very high voltage and high current. And they're also frequency dependent, but some other factors are also, you know, they also contribute in that. So that depends. What are those? We will see in our next slides. So what happens? The linear system resonance is the phenomenon behind the magnification of the harmonics, okay, in the power system, which we know already about the linear systems. Now, what happens when the ferroresonance, which is causing, you know, or resulting a very high voltage and current, but they will give you a very irregular and the chaotic waveforms. You know, so you can see, I will just show you the waveforms where you can see the shape. Waveforms are very irregular in nature. Fine, the concept of the ferroresonance can be explained in terms of linear system resonance. So first I'm going to take a very simple example where you have understood the concept of resonance with the help of an RLC circuit. So if I understand the concept of RLC circuit, series circuit, it is very easy for you to understand the concept of ferroresonance. So we know that there is an RLC circuit. When I talk about, I have an inductance, you know, XL, the inductive reactance, inductive capacitance, as well as R. So when I talk about a resonance, the resonance will be defined when, you know, when you're, the condition will occur when your XL becomes equal to XC. So we say that the current flowing in the circuit, if I for a moment, I neglect the value of the resistor, then the current equation will be somewhat as shown on screen. That is, it's E divided by J XL minus of X. So basically it is a difference between both the reactants, you know. So we also say that the, you know, this is where, what the resistance is doing over here. So, you know, when you give a resistor, because when your situation occurs that both becomes same, that means you're talking about a very huge current flowing in the circuit. And this huge current will be somewhere, should be restricted with the help of the resistor. So that is what we see in the further slides. So what happens, this is what I have absolutely, I just told you, when this XL becomes equal to the magnitude of XC, what happened, the series resonant phenomena occurs, and the equation, what has shown before you, will become, and show the current equation, which has shown you, will become infinitely large, and then in reality would be limited by the value of R. Fine, so the alternate solution for these RLC circuit can be obtained by writing the two equations. What do you mean by an alternate solutions? That means I can understand this concept with the help of two equations, and I will represent these two equations in the graphical form. Fine. So that graph will help us to understand exactly what are the operating points in the system when exactly this phenomena takes place. Fine. So from your system, you know the voltage across your inductor is nothing but JXL of I. Fine. And when I put this, V can also be represented in terms of, you know, I'll just go back and I'll just tell you how to get this equation. So when you cross multiply this equation, so this JXL into I is nothing but the voltage drop across your inductor, right? Because exactly I want to know what happens to the, you know, the basic difference between the ferroresonance is that we call it as a jump effect. What do I mean by a jump effect? In case of a ferroresonance, your operating level is just jumping from one operating point to another operating point. Fine. So that is the major difference between your resonance and ferroresonance. So in this case, you are seeing a sudden shift of an operating point from one operating level to another level. Fine. So this is what we are right now talking about. So when I want to know about this, what happening to the operating, the voltage level at the transformer. So what is that voltage across this? Because this inductive component is nothing but your transformer in a practical scenario. What is this XC? This is basically, that is the cabling, which is connected in series with your transformer. Fine. So now what happens over here? The inductance, the voltage across this inductance is nothing but I multiplied by your XL, correct? Now, when I cross multiply by this, so what do I get it? IJ into IXL, which is nothing but your small v, which is, I have defined the voltage across this will be as a, fine. So I just take this as a, the voltage across this particular is a small v, fine. So this particular small v is going to be, so when you multiply this, so what do you get it as? You get it as I into XL, okay, J term is there, JXL minus I into JXC is equal to E, is equal to E. So now when you try to rewrite this equation, what do you get? What is your J into XL? It is nothing but V. It's a drop across this. So I can write this as E plus, okay, I into J of XC. Fine. So that is what you are basically talking about, the voltage across the inductor. So that is what it is represented in the two equations, right? That's the exact expression which we get it over here. And with these two, where V is the voltage variable, how the voltage is varying when these ferroresonance phenomena is happening, right? So now we will understand these two equations with the help of a graph. Right, so now this is your graph. This is a graphical solution to the linear LC circuit. So here what we see is the figure shows the graphical solution of these two equations. So I have taken two values. Let me take the pointer. Fine. So here you have a two values of XL and XL dash. So we have taken a two inductors value and we have drawn the, you know, the graph for that particular curve. Fine. So you remember that we are going to do that, that XL dash, it represents a series resonance condition. So this is exactly where the series resonance condition is taking place. How? That we will, I will explain. Now what happened when a normal case, when the intersection point, this is your XC curve for a capacitive effect. So for the capacitive effect, when you draw the curve, so this point is somewhere coinciding, intersecting with your point of XL. Fine. So this is my one XL value and here my XL value changes. So with these two values, whereas XC value is for an instant, I've taken one XC value and I'm comparing with two XL value. So you can see the normal point where it is intersecting, that point will give you the exactly voltage across your inductor. Fine. So you can see that how you are described, that voltage across the inductor is nothing but your supply voltage plus the voltage across your capacitor. Fine, that is what we have written in the form of equation. Now, when I say if this is the dotted line which is shown at the different value of X dash L, and I say this is a series resonance condition, which means you can see that XC and XL are in parallel. Fine, so when they are in parallel, that means they are going to intersect somewhere at a very large value of voltage and current. You can see your y-axis is voltage and the x-axis is current. So these two, which are right now in parallel, at the point of ferroresonance, when the voltage and current is going to be too high, that is the point where you are going to get the intersection point. Is it okay? So that's how we represent that the ferroresonance when that particular phenomena of ferroresonance occurs. It can also be visible with the help of the graphical solution. Fine. Now I take another case where you talk about a nonlinear LC circuit. So basically, I'm talking over here about the nonlinear LC circuit. So here you can see that there may be a more than one intersection where you have seen in the previous case. Fine, where you are getting only a one intersection point for linear system. Now here, when you talk about a nonlinear system, so this is your nonlinear behavior of the inductor. You can check this. So for when I talk about a nonlinear system, so nonlinear inductor is going to behave like this. I hope all of you are aware about the shape. Fine. So this is a nonlinear behavior of your inductor. And when you take a study of nonlinear behavior and you plot a graph of XC, this is your XC graph. So this is your XC plot. So you can now check there is more than one intersection point in your solution. So you get a point number one, point number two, and point number three. So this is the point number two. So this point number two is basically, just let me lift up. Yeah. So this is the point number two. You can see this is an XC graph. So this is the point number two, which is, you know, very unstable. This is a point of ferroresonance, which is meeting and which is very, very unstable. Whereas point one number and three point, intersection point one and intersection point three will be considered as a stable operation. But at the point number three, your voltage and current is going to be very high. Fine. So this is basically point number one gives you a low voltage. It talks about a low voltage and a lagging current. You can check over here. Current is lagging. So this is the point of operation where the voltage system voltage is low and the current is lagging. And here where the system voltage is very high and the current is leading. So that is how you can understand the overall performance of your system with the help of this graphical solution. So what it is written? Yes, let us read. Intersection 2 is an unstable solution and this operating point gives rise to some of the chaotic behavior of ferroresonance. Fine. So that's what I told you. This particular point is unstable and it gives you a certain chaotic behavior of your system. Fine. So intersection 1 and 3 are defined to be as a stable system under steady state. And intersection 3 results a very high voltage and high current. I've already told you. So now what happens when C is yes? So before I go to the next one. So now what happens if you want to avoid this, you know, fine. So you can see this is the arrow mark shows that your inter capacitance is increasing. So you can see when the capacitance value is low, your characteristics is quite steep. The characteristics is very steep. And your intersection point, you can see throughout it is intersecting only at one point. So when your capacitance values are low, the intersection, it is intersecting at only one point of your inductance curve. But as your capacitance value increases, you can see that the intersection point from one, it goes to three. The question comes, how do I come out of this? Because the point two gives you the effect of ferroresonance. So how do I come out of these, this particular, what do you call it as? The effect, ferroresonance effect. So if you have to avoid this, what does it mean? That means my capacitance value should be further increased, because as your capacitance value will further increase, your curve may only intersect at point one and point three. So at higher value of inductance, the intersection point may only have a point one and point three. So when C is very large, the capacitive reactance line will intersect only at point one and three, which I've already told you. So one operating state is very low voltage, which I told you operating point number one, so which is at very low voltage and lagging power factor, and operating point three, which is having a very high voltage and leading current. Okay. So the operating points during ferroresonance can, so basically your operating point will be, you know, toggling between your point one and three. Often the resistance in the, yes. So as I told you, if you have to avoid the effect of the ferroresonance, what do you have to do it? There are the two possible ways which you can act upon very fast. One thing is either you have to insert a resistance on the secondary of your transformer, fine, or you have to take a quick action on your input side of the voltage by using some three-phase interruption device. So this interruption device can be your circuit breakers. Fine, because you know the ferroresonance will occur. This type of phenomena will occur when your one of the line gets open, okay, other two lines are connected, or when you are taking a switching actions, which we'll be seeing in next slide, because switching actions are not taking all the three at the time. There are certain duration, time duration or time delay. And if that thing happens, and if that persists for a long time, then it really causes a huge damage to your distribution side or feeder side equipments. Fine. So what we see that the example of ferroresonance, yes. So we wanted to show you, this is typically a graph of at intersection point two. Okay, so I'm basically talking about this graph shows you intersection point two. And you can see, as we have told, the graph goes very chaotic. It's irregular, completely it is irregular, and it is very, very chaotic. So it is a typical example of unstable voltage which has been monitored during the point two, that is your ferroresonant condition. So you can see how the system voltage will be irregular in nature. Right? Similarly, I'll show you one more graph. So this particular graph implies what? This is typically showing you at the intersection point three, because what happens, my dear friends, at the intersection point three, your voltage shoots up. The voltage and currents are very high. So this particular graph is talking only keeping the voltage in mind. So you can see the voltage has jumped to more than four per unit. Fine. So it is jumping from one or two per unit to four per unit, and it takes some time to settle down. So it is taking after certain cycle, and you can see then after taking certain cycle only, it is going to settle down. Fine. So these are called as initial transients. So these are the transients occurring into the system due to the phenomena of ferroresonance. So I hope you have understood the concept of ferroresonance and how they, you know, insert or how they bring the effect of transient into the system. Fine. So the capacitance was varied to achieve different operating point after an initial transient that pushes the system into resonance. Fine, that's understood. I have explained to you already that suddenly there is a jump of voltage from 2 per unit to 4 per unit. You can see that. Either condition can impose excessive, that is what I told you exactly. If this kind of transient behavior of the system due to ferroresonance exists for more duration, then it is a really a big question mark for your end user equipments. Fine. So for a small capacitance, the XC is, I told you about this, for a less value, the XC graph is very steep and it has only one intersection point, that is at quadrant three, that is the intersection point three, right? So it will only give you a point at third quadrant. Okay, the most common events leading to ferroresonance, very interesting topic, when the ferroresonance will occur. Now you can see I am just energizing the transformer. So it is happening. So you can see this is a transformer, three phases. Okay, ABC, and these are the lines which are going and are giving you a capacitance effect with respect to the ground. Okay, so now here what is happening exactly over here, you are energizing your transformer. So your two switches are open and one is closed. Okay, or either this will happen in case of energizing, or it will happen in case of de-energizing of transformer. So what happens? Manual switching of an unloaded cable fed. So it is a manual switching. You are basically talking about a manual switching of an unloaded cable fed transformer where only one phase is closed. Ferroresonance may be noted when the first phase is closed upon energizing or before the last phase is opened on de-energizing. As simple as that. Fine. So you have the time duration which you take to energize individual phases matters a lot. So if this duration increases, it may, it may damage the insulation also of their cable and the windings, apart from the equipments. So it is also a big question mark for your, for the insulation of the cables. Now, another thing also on the same thing, when you manual switching off an unloaded cable fed three phase transformer. So what we see over here, where one of the phases are open. So now here you're basically talking about the switching action. So here when you are switching the transformer one by one phase, whether you are energizing it or de-energizing it, the same phenomena can be seen. So one or two riser pole fuses may usually, when they do that manually, the normal thing what they see is one of the fuses may blow off. Fine. So it is usually seen that there will be a blow of fuses leaving a transformer with one or two phases open. Single phase reclosures may also cause this condition. So whether you are opening or whether you are closing a single phase or keeping the two phases open, such kind of phenomena can be seen. But now it's a modern power system. And in this modern power system, your commercial loads will always have a backup. Because as I told you, if this phenomena occurs, and it occurs, usually it occurs for 0.5 cycles, a half a cycle, So it is the transient behavior is for a very short period. But for any reason, if this period extends, then it will lead to a lot of, damages into the system. So for that reason, always there will be a backup system present in the power system. So for that reason, it's written today, many modern commercial loads have controlled the transfer of the load to backup systems when they sense these kind of conditions are going to take place. Is it okay? Now, system conditions that help increase the likelihood of ferroresonance include. So what are the things which can bring the effect of, or which can cause the effect of ferroresonance? Fine. So what is the first thing? Higher distribution voltage level. So these kind of effects are usually seen from medium voltage, actually from medium voltage to higher voltages. You can see that this kind of effects are happening. Fine. So here we see that mostly notably in 25 and 35 kilovolt class systems, and even above that also. Switching off lightly loaded and unloaded, this just now we have discussed. So whether you are switching action, you are turning on, or you're switching any one of the phases, when the transformer is loaded or unloaded, you can see such kind of phenomena are taking place. Fine. Then ungrounded transformer, primary connections. So your transformers are, primary of the transformer is not grounded. Okay. So very lengthy underground cable circuits. So it also depends on your underground cables, you know, because underground cables plays a very huge role giving you the capacitance effect. So if that is also there, so you have to think about if your underground cables are very lengthy, then you can expect such kind of phenomena to occur. Cable damage and manual switching during the construction of underground cable systems, just now we have discussed. Weak system, so your system is weak. Your system is does not have the immunity to sustain any sort of faults, you know, then the short circuit will happen, and any short circuit will result you a transients, fine. So low loss transformers, and then three phase systems with single phase switching devices. You have a three phase system, but your switching device is a single phase. So that means your switching can take place one phase at a time. So in that cases, we can see such kind of phenomena are taking place. Okay, common indicators of ferroresonance. Now, so long what we have studied? We have studied what is the concept of ferroresonance, when it happens, how it happens, fine, and what are the reasons behind this particular phenomena. Now, what we are going to study is, how do I come to know that this particular effect has happened? What are the indicators which will help me to understand, yes, ferroresonance, this particular phenomenon has happened. So what happened, guys? The very first thing, what you can get a noise, fine? So you will get an audible noise, some noise which is a buzzer sound or hiss sound, you will be able to hear when such kind of, you know, the phenomenon is taking place. So usually, as I told you, why that sound will come? Because your voltage will suddenly jump, your current will be suddenly very high, it will shoot up. For a short period of time, it is going to shoot up to a very high value, and it will completely, that means your operating level is completely shifting from one level to another level. So that will be usually heard by a sound, you know. So you will get some certain kind of audible noise, which will help you to understand that this noise may be due to the effect of ferroresonance. Second thing which we see is that this kind of, because as I told you, iron core gets saturated, and if the iron core gets saturated, it will be in terms of heat. Fine. So that will make your body of the transformer is very, very overheated. Fine. So transformer overheating often, although not always, accompanies ferroresonance. This is special. This is one of the reasons. It is not telling that heating of the transformer, the reason behind the heating of the transformer is the ferroresonance. That may be one of the reasons why your transformer core got heated up. Fine. So this is especially true when the core is driven deep into saturation. As I told you, it should be noted that some transformer exhibiting signs of ferroresonance, such as loud chaotic noises, do not show signs of appreciable heating. The design of the transformer and the because you may get the sound, you know, but as I told you, this will happen for a very short period. So if it happened for a short period, you may get a sound, but the core may not get heated up. So core will get heated up when it is going for a, when your duration increases. Is it okay? Third thing, we see that high over voltages and surge arrestor failure. So as the switching action takes place, as we have seen, fuses will blow off, arrestors will blow off at the another end. So what happens when the over voltages accompany ferroresonance? Okay. So as I told you, this will usually, you can see such kind of concepts in the high voltage ends. Fine. So when over voltages accompany this ferroresonance, there could be electrical damage to both the primary and secondary circuits. Fine. Surge arrestors are common casualties of the event, because surge arrestors are something, are your protective devices. So they are added into your system to protect your device, because as your transformer is very, very costly. Okay. So it is very costly. So you cannot, we cannot even think about shutting down of a transformer due to some sort of failure in the transformer. So definitely I should have before the transformer and after the transformer, there should be usually placed surge arrestors. So when the switching action takes place or opening of any one of the phases takes place, so this phenomena may result into the failures of these surge arrestors, fine? So they are basically damaging themselves and protecting the device. So low voltage arrestors in the end user facilities are more susceptible than the utility arrestors, and their failure is sometimes the only indication that the ferroresonance has occurred. So from your low voltage side ends, when you see this kind of arrestors are failing, it's understood that due to the ferroresonance only this has happened. Then the flickering. So we see that when there is a sudden inrush of current or inrush, you know, the voltage has increased at such a high value, you can very clearly noticeable, even sitting at your home, the lights are starts going to be dimmer. Okay. So it, you can see that the effect during ferroresonance, the voltage magnitude may fluctuate widely. So you can see that fluctuation flickering of your light. So end users at the secondary circuit may actually see their light bulbs flicker. Some electronic appliances may be very susceptible to such kind of voltage excursions, which we have discussed previously also, that how your, you know, the electronic gadgets are so sensitive towards this kind of voltage issues. So they expose can, so what will happen? If too much flickering happen into the system, what will happen? The lifespan of the equipments will automatically reduce. Okay, now we'll talk about what are the other switching transients. So we have seen the major switching transients, which we have seen is one of the basic concepts which we have learned is a ferroresonance effect. Okay, so now what are the other switching transients? So they are line energizing transients. So line energizing is when you are energizing a particular line, you are adding a line to a power system. Fine. So basically you are energizing a line, and that implies when a switch is closed, connecting a line to the power system. So this is actually a general involvement of higher frequency content. Then so means what we tell is here your involve your frequency goes much more higher than what it happens in energizing of your capacitor. Fine. So here what we say, this is a combination of so many things. When I talk about a line energizing transients, this basically a combination of traveling wave effects. Fine. So this is a combination of traveling wave effects and then the interaction of your line capacitance, and then it is talking about your, you know, inductance of your line, that is your system equivalent source inductance. So you have the line capacitance, you have the source inductance, you have the traveling wave effects. All these three combinations will give you the effect of transient when you energize a particular line. Right? So what do you mean by traveling waves? How they come? Traveling waves are caused by the distributed nature of the capacitance and the inductance of the transmission line or the distribution line. So that is where the phenomena of the traveling waves comes into picture. So when all these effects together, we see that the line energy transients typically results benign over voltages, which means that it is not very, you know, it's not very serious. It's the condition is not very serious. We are talking about the over voltage may not be very high at the distribution level, but generally do not cause any concern. So they line energizing transients are not very, you know, serious as we have seen in the case of a ferroresonance. It's very unusual to implement any kind of switching control for line energizing. See, what we are trying to talk about in this particular line is when your line is having for a very high voltage, a very, very high voltage, I'm talking about 345 kV, there are extra high voltages, you know. So it's a high voltage and I go for an extra high voltages, there you have certain kind of control, the switching actions makes a sense. But for a low or medium voltages, usually no, there will be no, absolutely no control systems for switching actions, because this switching actions will be for very, very small duration. So their impact on the system is very less. So keeping that thing in mind, so such kind of controls of switching controls will be provided for a very high voltage lines. Fine. Then the energizing transient on the distribution feeder circuit consists of combination of, so when I talk about a distribution feeder, and these energizing transients are basically consist of line energizing transients. That means what are the transients which you face on the distribution end? That is, one is line energizing transients, that is your transformer energizing and your load inrush current. I repeat, line energizing, transformer energizing, and your inrush current of the load. Fine. So these are the three major factors which will contribute in your energy transients into the distribution end. Right? So line energizing transient do not usually pose a problem for the end user. So end users are who? We, the consumers. So we are the consumers, and when the line is getting energized, we are not at a very, you know, it's not a very much problematic condition for us. It's not from the end user level, you absolutely have no problem. But because as all the equipments at the higher frequency components are protected with the help of some sort of inductive chokes or surge protective devices. So therefore, the reason why we say is, it's not a big matter. It will not give a cause a trouble at the end user level. Fine. So now here you can see the effect of the line energization. So what you will see at the distribution feeder. So one, the first one gives you the voltage, and second one gives the current. So you can see a flat. Fine. So you can see that the curve at the beginning over here, just like this, a flat dash. Why this dash is coming? Okay, we will see that, and then it will take some time, and then it will settle down. So it will take some time for the voltage, especially for the current. And this current plays a very important vital role, because we are talking about inrush of the load current. You are immediately putting the load into the system, so there will be inrush of current into the system. So you can see that it is a typical case of in which the monitor was located on the line side of the switch. Fine. So here the initial transient frequency is above 1 kilohertz and appears as small amount of hash. You are talking about a very high frequency, and therefore you can see that the flat curve where you have seen is completely flat. That is due to the very high transient frequency at the initial point. So following the energization, the voltage displays noticeable distortion. Obviously, when you are energizing a line, typical line, fine. So what we see, and we have kept that this waveforms has been taken, kept very next to the where you are energizing the line, the switches. You know, we want to see what happens exactly to the system. Since the system is having a very high transient frequency initially, it will have, so that you can see it's completely flat at the beginning. Fine. Once it getting up following that energization, the voltage displays are distorted because it takes some time to settle down, because there will be a high inrush of current. Fine. And this inrush of current will have a very low order of harmonic, including second and fourth order. Now, this is evidenced by the lack of symmetry. How do I notice that there is a harmonic component, and due to the inrush of current, you can see that your voltage form waveform is not symmetrical at the beginning. It takes some time to come back to its steady state. Okay, the first peak of the current waveform displays the basic characteristics of the magnetizing inrush, which is subsequently swamped by the load inrush current. We have already discussed this. Fine. Another, just now we have told about the other switching components, other transient components. That is, first we say we have seen that the line switching. You know, so when you switch on the line, what will happen to your transients? How does the transients affect, and what are the combination? What are the reasons which totally combines together and give you that transient effect? Fine. So similarly, there is another source of over voltages or over currents, which we call it as single line to ground fault. Fine. So you know what will happen when there is a single line to ground fault will happen. So in this case, what will happen? You're on a system with a high zero sequence impedance. The sound phase will experience a voltage rise during the fault. Fine. So you know the zero sequence fault will be impedance will be very high at that particular point. So the typically voltage rise effectively. So the voltage rise will be very high for a four wire multi-grounded neutral systems, and it will be around 15 to 20% more. That's what's pretty high. Fine. So in this, what happened? This over voltages temporarily disappear. How do I control these over voltages? Because you would have studied in your power system analysis where these single line to ground faults can be controlled by the limiting. You will be using a reactors. So there you will be using a fault limiting reactors in your neutral line, which will help to control this type of faults. These over voltages are not often a problem. Okay, so as I told you, they are not very severe as your ferro resonance effect, fine. They are not very serious, but definitely they will impact some of the systems function if the process is very slow. You know, process means I'm talking about the fault clearing process. So if the fault has occurred and this fault clearing process is very slow, then definitely it will impact on the system equipments. Fine. So now what are these? That is what we tell. Some secondary arrestors installed by the end users attempt to clamp the voltage to as low as 110% voltage. So what will happen? So this believe that this offers a better insulation protection. So such arrestors are subjected to failure when conducting several cycles of power frequency current. So if you take a longer period to correct this, it will, your many of your equipment in your system is going to fail one by one, fine. So that it matters if I have set a voltage, what is my threshold value, whether my threshold value of the equipment is matching with my systems, all the other equipments or not. If it is not able to synchronize, then definitely arrestors are going to fail. Then what are we talking about the ASDs? So ASDs may presume, because you know, I, as you would have discussed in your, you have studied in other modules of your power quality, that ASDs many times they trip without any reason, you know. So we say that ASD will, that your adjustable speed drive controls may presume a failure, thinking that the DC bus voltage has increased and has tripped the machine. So once it senses that the DC voltage goes high and that DC voltage is high for a longer, little bit longer period than the usual, then immediately ASD will think that I need to drop. There's something wrong at my input end. Fine. So that is where the things are happening, is unnecessarily the drives are going to trip. And if the drives trip, automatically machine is going to trip. Fine. So that means a whole process, manufacturing process for a big industries may come to a halt because of some transients which has not been resolved at the initial end. It has taken long time. The faults has taken a long time for clearing the particular fault. Fine. So if you take a long time for clearing the fault, these are the things which can happen into your system. So what we see in the distributing generation interconnected with the utility system will often interrupt voltage in excess of 120%. So here now you see. So here normally in distributed generation, if your voltage goes excess of 120% as warranting immediate disconnection, automatically you will have a shutdown in your area. Fine. So you are simply having instead of taking the clearing of the fault for a 0.5 cycle, it goes to a more than that duration. Immediately system thinks something is wrong, but the system is able to withstand that fault and system can run healthy in that situation also. But if the fault clearing time goes beyond a certain period, system automatically, as your whole system is interconnected and automatic, you know, it's completely modern and everything has been designed such that if any fault has occurred for a certain duration and it has exceeded that particular limit, immediately it will start tripping off. All the protective devices will come into action and will start tripping the other interconnected system. So where in such certain cases, what is happening, where your system is designed, foolproof design, it is able to withstand the fault even for a little bit longer period, but due to the delay in clearing the fault, the system will simply, start tripping off all the, system will simply trip. So that means your all the loads get disconnected, fine. Suppose the actual impact of this overvoltage on the secondary side of the system depends heavily on the service transformer connection. Obviously, how does your service transformers is going to take up the load, how it is connected, it all depends into that. But these are the things which we have to keep it in mind when the protection devices are designed and put it for the safety of the whole power system. Okay. With this, we come to an end of today's lecture. I hope all of you have enjoyed, and definitely I'll be waiting to see you all in my next lecture. Thank you. Bye. Take care.